This video is brought to you by CuriosityStream. Get the best documentaries online on the link down below. Chances are you might have heard the news. Raspberry is releasing a new device. Finally, we leave the tree behind and play around with the Raspberry Pi 4. While I'm sure many of you will be rushing to get their hands on the new device, there's a bit of a secret I have been keeping for the last few weeks. I have an early unit, and that means that we get to explore it a bit early on this preview. Let's begin with what has changed, and who better to deliver the first explanation than Eben Upton, co-founder of the Raspberry Pi Foundation and one of the original creators of Raspberry Pi, and current CEO of Raspberry Pi Trading. I interviewed Mr. Upton when I visited Cambridge for checking out the Raspberry Pi store, and we ended up talking about a variety of topics that you might have caught if you have seen some of the previous Raspberry Pi centered videos. Now, the thing is that at the end of the interview, he had an unexpected surprise for me.
What's this? This is a Raspberry Pi 4. It's our next Raspberry Pi. Do you want me to take you on a tour around the board?
Yes, please.
Okay, here we go. So, we've got a new processor. This is a BCM2711. It's the successor to the 2837 that we used on Raspberry Pi 3. It's got a quad Cortex A72 at 1.5 GHz. It's, let's say, depending on your workload, I think three times the kind of number we've sort of settled on is three times as powerful as a Raspberry Pi 3. We've changed memory technology, so now we can support up to 4 GB of LPDDR4 memory. So we have 1, 2, and 4 GB SKUs of the product. We've retained the 802.11ac Wi-Fi from Raspberry Pi 3 Plus. That's exactly the same chipset with exactly the same antenna. I think we picked up an upgrade to Bluetooth 5 along the way, a software upgrade to Bluetooth 5. Over at this end of the board, you'll notice the Ethernet connector has moved up to the top of this edge. Usually on previous Pis, the Ethernet connector's down here. But this is a gigabit Ethernet connector, and it's a full rate gigabit. For the first time, this is a full rate gigabit connector. So you can get your full, 900 and some megabits a second of iPerf traffic through that. And that's a dedicated link from the SoC, so that bandwidth isn't shared with anything else. On the end here, still 4 USBs, but you'll see two of them have turned blue. So two of these are USB 3, two of these are USB 2, and these all come via this chip here, which is a PCI Express to USB bridge chip of the sort you'd typically find in a PC. Other changes are on the bottom edge, I guess. We have a pair of HDMI, a pair of micro HDMI connectors. So for the first time, this can drive like two displays simultaneously. We can drive 4K P60. We can decode 4K P60 HEVC video. If you want to drive two, I think we're going to limit people to 4K P30, just because the memory bandwidths get a bit horrific if you try and do dual 4K P60. And then on this side, you'll see this has turned from a USB micro B into a USB-C connector, so we can get a little bit more power in through a little more power into the board. The main reason for getting more power into the board is to get more power out of the board. So this improves the amount of power that's available for delivery downstream to USB devices. The overall thermal budget for the platform itself is broadly the same as Raspberry Pi 3B Plus. So that's Raspberry Pi 4, and we hope you like it.
Let's walk through some of those changes and what that could mean. First is the expected improvement on the CPU. The improvement in performance that you're going to see jumping to the next generation will depend a lot on the workload, and in the most extreme cases, the new device can appear several times more powerful. I decided to run a quick test with the Raspberry Pis I could find using SysBench, both running on all 4 cores and then just in a single core. In both cases, you can see a very strong reduction in test times, especially in the multi-core test, where times are cut on a third, not bad for starters. On the connectivity front, the Ethernet makes an interesting change. Previous versions of the Raspberry Pi had their Ethernet speed limited by a slower USB 2.0 bus. Both the limit on USB speed and Ethernet were probably a constant annoyance to the number of local network media centers powered by Pis out there. Since the Pi 4 finally jumps into USB 3.0, it is also able to do full gigabit internet, which is likely to make a lot of those people really happy, especially those trying to boot from USB or network directly to a Pi. I do wonder why they shifted the position of the USB ports and Ethernet, as it might break some of the older cases and accessories, but on previous conversations with Mr. Upton, he has mentioned how a lot of the details of the design of the Raspberry had to do with keeping within the budget, so I will not be surprised if this is a change in order to maintain cost. The power connector has changed from micro USB to USB Type-C. From what I understand, the recent Raspberry Pi has used a micro USB port for power until now is their easy availability. Thanks to widespread smartphone use, these chargers and cables are everywhere. USB Type-C is a bit newer and a bit less omnipresent, but since it's starting to show on more and more mainstream devices, they're likely cheap enough as connectors to work under the Pi's tight cost budget. I do wonder if they will prove to be resistant enough for some of the messier projects out there, but the change seems for a good reason, as it can allow the device to use up to 3 amps versus the 2.5 of micro USB. Getting more power in to output more power for accessories is likely a direct reaction to the way the community has been using the Pi. Even some of the most standard projects out there are getting ambitious at what they can power using the direct pins or USB. The mini arcade that I put together on a previous video powers the screen directly from USB, and now people are likely going to get more ambitious because of the next point. Dual screen capabilities. The Raspberry Pi 4 changes one full HDMI connector for two micro HDMIs. The male micro HDMI connector can be fragile at times and harder to find at regular HDMIs. So once again, a little convenience seems to have been sacrificed for a new feature, which is the dual screen support. The Raspberry Pi can now do two screens at once. Now, the change to Type-C seemed like an obvious reaction to the needs of the community and a net positive. For the dual screen feature, I am initially not super excited about it, but it will probably be useful for the amount of people that are using Pis to power kiosks of different kinds. And I already can think of a couple of interesting gaming uses. I expect this change to generate some interesting discussion. If this is a net positive will depend on the things people come up that use this new feature. We will see about that soon enough. An interesting point that I did not go into is the change in RAM. Changes in generation usually come with a gradual increase in memory, but this generation does something a bit different. The folks from Raspberry Pi have been experimenting with the format and pricing of their microcomputers to adjust to the unexpected uses people have found to their devices, which has led to stuff like the crazy good and cheap Zero to the industry-focused compute model. This time, things take a turn with different models of the same device with more or less RAM, which I imagine is a response to the growing number of users doing much bigger and more complex projects. No longer is the main model only $35. The 1GB version is still $35, but with extra RAM comes an increase in price, with 4GB being the most expensive Raspberry Pi in a while. Although, being realistic, it is still less than a big gamer release, so I might be being overly dramatic on this. Still, at the end of the day, the option for more memory is there for the people that need it. And this, again, is going to depend very much on what people are going to do with this. Are we going to see some interesting projects that make use of all the extra memory to enable amazing stuff? Are there any specific projects out there that were being limited by the lack of memory of the Pi 3B Plus? If that is the case, this might have been the correct decision. Now, since I have been fiddling around with what is basically pre-release software, I have been unable to compile most of the games and emulators I want to fully test with this due to some bugs, and that is why this is a preview. Now that the full final version is out, I will be working on that, so keep an eye out. One of the reasons why I love Raspberry Pis is that they represent a fantastic snapshot of the technological capabilities of the industry at a specific place in time. Let me explain what I mean. Old Nintendo designer Gunpei Yokoi, the father of the Game Boy, had this fascination with ignoring bleeding-edge technology for finding better uses for existing cheap and well-understood technology. This is why the Game Boy seemed outdated compared to other handhelds, but was much cheaper, had better battery life, and was way more practical. And you can see the influence his philosophy had all the way up to modern Nintendo. And you can easily see how I find this interesting in my personal way of thinking about technology. In the same vein, the main Raspberry Pi computers are a fascinating representation of the cheapening cost of technology. No Raspberry Pi is really made from the latest tech available, but rather things that the industry understands and produces well enough that it can be made for a very low cost. This is combined with the efforts of a team of people who are constantly looking for creative ways to pack more on this device, while keeping a tight budget, and while maintaining and providing an optimized open source operating system for it. Either way, the first part of the Raspberry Pi experience is the community effort, and now that this device is out there in the world, I'm excited to see what it will be used for. I am personally very curious to see when RetroPie is going to fully support it, since I expect its extra power to allow for some rather ambitious emulation. This is likely going to be a future video topic, so you know what to do if you want to find out. Right now, there are tons of interesting uses for these mini PCs. For example, in the Airbnb where I was staying during my short time in London, there was no like smart TV or anything that could read media of any kind, so I used some of the Pis that I got from these videos simply as media consumption devices, and my favorite background media to have there was some of the excellent documentaries in CuriosityStream. Such as Catalyst, a look into what the heck is quantum computers and why they matter, or Cyberwar, a nice long documentary on the dark world of hacking, vulnerabilities, and the effect that the general lack of proper cybersecurity is causing. CuriosityStream is an online streaming service from the founders of the Discovery Channel, with over 2,400 high-quality documentaries and generally interesting content. It is available via browser or app, which works on the Raspberry Pi, or even on a really cheap phone. They have free content for you to get started with, and their limited access starts at $3 a month, which is a pretty low price for something that's going to improve your media diet a lot. And if you use the link in the description or the code LowSpecGamer, your first 30 days are free. Their support has been invaluable for keeping this channel going, so be sure to show them some love. And as always, thanks for watching.